Hey everyone, my name's Robert. I teach deep learning for SAS. Today, I'm going to give you a practitioner's guide to building a deep learning model. Now, it's often when I teach students, I get the question, how do you know how many hidden layers to use in your neural network? Or how do you know how many neurons or the type of layer that you should add to a neural network? Well, today I'm going to give you a tip. It's a practitioner's tip that you can use to answer those questions. Let's take a look. So when you build a deep learning model, you want to begin with a small subset of the data, and you're going to maybe add a layer. Let me try a different color. There we go. So you start with a small subset of the data, and then you add a layer, and you train the model on that one layer. So you'll see something like this. Model performance won't be great. As you modify your network, you added maybe additional layers, or you change the layers, maybe add more complexity, you should see that your performance on the training data, and you're only looking at the training data right now, should improve. That is, that curve is going to come down. So over here on the y-axis, we have our error, and on the x-axis, we have our iterations. So as we add complexity, we would like to see the training performance improve. If you add complexity and the training performance does not improve, that's probably the wrong move. Try something else. So what you're looking for is you're looking for a model structure that fits the data really well. That is, the training data really well. One other point to keep in mind. If you add complexity and performance improves, but the time, the computational cost is very expensive, that's maybe not the right move. So you're really looking for changes to the structure that improve the training performance, as well as don't add too much computational cost, or additional computation, I should say. So after you have a model that fits that small subset of the data well, now you bring in a small subset of the validation data. And when you first fit the model, you're going to see something that looks kind of like this, where there's this huge divergence between training and validation. That's okay. At this point in the model building process, you begin to add regularities to your model. You can add dropout. Maybe try adding dropout to the first hidden layer. Try adding batch normalization to several of the layers. As you do this, what you'll likely see is that the performance on the validation data is going to improve, and performance on the training data is going to begin to suffer, but that's okay, because we're looking for a model that's going to generalize well. And what you'll ultimately arrive at is you'll have these two curves basically converge. Now I'm going to show you an actual example. This is a model that I built within SAS. So here I have a program that I previously wrote. The program begins by specifying the model structure, and then after this I run a model information action to give me some details about the model. And then from here on out I'm just printing out pictures that show different iteration plots and basically tell a story. So let's run the program. Now there are multiple ways to view pictures in SAS Studio. In my program I just use one of the several different ways. So this is the model that we're going to start with. Here I've already done some work. I've already gone through this process that I just described. And I have this model that has 6 convolutional layers. So I've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Actually, I could circle this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. It has 4 pooling layers. Let's change the color. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1 concatenation right here, and 1 fully connected and 1 output layer. Let me clear that ink and let's scroll down. So this is the model that we're starting with. So this is an actual model that I worked on, and let's take a look at what I did. So here's the iteration plot. We're on the x-axis, I have a misclassification rate. I'm predicting 10 different classes. And on the y-axis, I have my epochs. The first change that I made is I doubled the number of filters in the first set of convolutional layers. So I increased the number of filters from 3 to 6. And notice that my training misclassification rate went from 30.39% down to 23.54%. The time it took to run the model only increased by 3 seconds. And the timing wasn't very scientific. I was just using my phone off to the side, keeping time every time I hit the run button. So that was a good change. I had nice improvement and it wasn't too expensive. The next change that I made is that I doubled the number of filters in the second set of the convolutional layers. So I doubled the number from 16 to 32. In this case, the time increased from 24 to 28 seconds, but the performance of the model did not improve. So I doubled the number of filters on the first convolutional layer. It improved the model performance. So why not try it on the second convolutional layer? It didn't work well. So that was not the right move. Therefore, I undid that change. Next, I tried doubling the number of filters on the third convolutional layer. This worked. The previous best performing model was 23.54% misclassification rate on the training. And this new model now has a misclassification rate of 20.77%. And the cost in computation was only 1 second. The next change that I made is that I decreased the stride from 2 to 1 on the last, that is the third set of convolutional layers. Decreasing the stride effectively increases the amount of data that's fed to the fully connected neurons. So there was a computational cost there, as well as the weights and the filters themselves. But you'll notice that the performance of the model and the training data didn't really improve. It basically stayed the same. So that wasn't the right move. I then tried to decrease the stride from 2 to 1 on the last set of pooling layers. This also was not the right move to make because performance on the training data did not improve and we had a cost in time. Next, I tried to decrease the stride from 2 to 1 on the first set of pooling layers. Now, this actually improved the model quite significantly. We went from 20% misclassification down to about 18.5%. But the time that it took for me to train this model was quite substantial. So there was a large cost to this change. Ultimately, I decided to not make this change. So I reverted back to the previous champion model. Next, I added a fully connected layer with 135 neurons. So this is in addition to that first fully connected layer, I added a second fully connected layer. And there was very little cost in computation, but I saw good improvement in the training data. And actually, this may not be the right graph here. I believe performance improved to about 19%, but you get the idea. So this is just a small example of what practitioners do to answer those questions. How do I know how many hidden layers to use? How many hidden neurons to use? Or what types of layers? It's trial and error. It's always data problem specific. Start with a small subset, build a model structure that fits that subset well, and then go back and regularize the model. Now, in this one example, I didn't apply any regularizations because the model itself had a regularizing aspect in the model structure. That is, we have a cardinality of 2. Cardinality refers to separate independent paths within a neural network that are used for feature extraction. I hope you enjoyed this video and you were able to pick up some neat tips as to how to build a deep learning model. If you like this video, definitely subscribe. And down below, we have links to other resources in the description. And please leave me your comments and questions and I'll definitely get back to you. Take care.